Hello everyone. In this video, I'll be showing some instruments used in ear examination as well as ear surgery. So these are not the complete list of instruments, but these are the instruments which are most commonly used. Now this is Jobson's horn probe with ring curette. Now this instrument has two ends. One end is a ring, another end is a probe. The probe is serrated. It is a serrated ends. Now this instrument is used the ring side. It is used to remove the wax or foreign body from the ear. And the probe side, it is used to probe any polyp in the ear as well as also in the nose. Sometimes this probe end is also used as a earbud. Cotton is wrapped here and it is used to clean the ear. So this is Jobson's horn probe with ring curette. It can also be used to remove any discharge in the ear for dry mopping also. This is another instrument which is used for cleaning of the ear to remove the wax or foreign body, and this instrument is called ear vectis with cerumen spud. This ring end, it is a vectis end, and this is the cerumen spud. It is scoop like. This is also, it has a similar use for to remove the wax and the foreign body from the ear. This is Tilly's oral forceps. Tilly's. Now there are two types of oral forceps. One is Tilly's, another one is Hartmann's. Hartmann has a screw joint. This is Tilly's, it has a box joint. So to remember, we can remember like screw the heart. That is, Hartmann's has the screw joint. Another difference between the two forceps is that only the tip or the distal end of the blades, it is serrated in Tilly's forceps, while in Hartmann's forceps, the distal end, it is spade-like. The use of this forceps is to instill medicated wicks into the ear canal, to clean the ear, to also pack and unpack the nose. So sometimes it is also called Tilly's nasal dressing forceps. So, but originally it is Tilly's oral forceps. For example, in otitis externa, when we want to keep the medicated wick in the canal, this instrument can be used. It is also used sometimes to remove the foreign bodies from the ear and occasionally from the nose also. This is tuning fork. Now tuning fork, they come in different types. This is Gardiner tuning fork. It has a thumb rest here. Another type is Hartmann tuning fork. So generally tuning fork has two prongs, shoulder, the stem and the base. Now it comes in different frequencies which are in the multiple of 128. So 128, 256, 512, 1024 and so on. This particular rate is of 124 hertz frequency. Now tuning fork is struck at the distance of upper 1/3 and lower 2/3 of the prongs. So it is struck at this place and it is not struck on hard surface, because when we struck it on hard surface, it will produce overtones. Now generally 512 hertz tuning fork is most commonly used for routine ear hearing assessment, because 512 hertz tuning fork, it has tone decay is optimal, the overtones are minimal, it falls in the mid speech frequency, and it is more audible than tactile. So for routine Rinne test, Weber test and absolute bone conduction test, we use the tuning fork test of 512. The use of this tuning fork is to assess the hearing in patients, to know the type of the hearing, whether the hearing is of conductive or sensory neural, and also to know the degree of hearing. Degree of hearing can be assessed by using the battery of tuning forks. Now after striking the tuning fork, it is kept in the acoustic axis of the canal. It is kept like this. It should not be kept like this. It is kept like this at around 1.5 to 2 cm from the external auditory meatus. This instrument is Vogt's Eustachian catheter. Now this is an instrument which has a curved tip and a ring at this part. This is a ring. Now this ring faces in the direction of the tip. As the name suggests, it is used to check the patency of the Eustachian tube, to catheterize the Eustachian tube, to aerate the middle ear. However, because there are many non-invasive tests, for example impedance audiometry, nowadays available, to know the function of the eustachian tube. It is no longer used to check the patency or the function of the eustachian tube. More commonly, it is nowadays used to remove the foreign bodies from the nose. Also, sometimes it can be used as a suction cannula also, because this can suction from its tip. So sometimes it is can be used when the suction cannula is not available. Now, this is a handheld battery-driven otoscope. The speculum is attached here and the lens is convex lens. Battery is put inside and it gives a magnification of around 2 to 3 times. This lens is convex lens. Again, it is used for examination of the tympanic membrane, for examination of the ear canal, the middle ear. If there is perforation, it can also be seen through an otoscope. And the pinna, it should be pulled upwards, backwards and laterally so that we are able to see the tympanic membrane, because the external auditory canal is tortuous. To make it straight, the pinna should be pulled upwards, backwards and laterally. So this is an otoscope. This instrument is Politzer's myringotome. Now, myringotomy is a procedure in which we put an incision in the tympanic membrane to drain the middle ear fluid. The two most common indications of using this instrument are, first is acute suppurative otitis media, in which the incision is a radial, circumferential incision put in the posterior inferior quadrant. And more common than that, in children, it is otitis media with effusion, in which the incision is kept in the anterior inferior quadrant and it is a radial incision. So this is a bayonet shaped instrument. It is a curved instrument, and through this tip, incision is put over the tympanic membrane. Politzer's myringotome. This is Lampert suction cannula. This cannula is used for suctioning during any ear surgery, tympanoplasty, master surgery. Also, it is used for suctioning of blood and the secretions during any nasal surgery, for example, FES, septoplasty, SMI. This is Farabule's mastoid periosteum elevator. Now, this is a stout instrument which is used in ear surgeries, for example, tympanoplasty, any mastoid surgery, to elevate the periosteum, to make the bone bare before drilling. It is also used in other surgeries to elevate the soft tissue, for example, in maxillectomies, Cardwellar surgery or mandibulectomy. Farabule's periosteum elevator. This is Mollison's self-retaining hemostatic mastoid retractor. Now, it comes in different types. Now, this particular instrument here, it is having 4x4 prongs. So, this is called 4x4 Mollison's self-retaining mastoid retractor. It is used in ear surgery to retract the postoral tissues during tympanoplasty, any mastoid surgery. Also, sometimes it is used in laryngofissure to retract the soft tissue. Similar instrument is the Plaster Jensen or Plaster 4x3 hemostatic mastoid retractor, in which it can be seen that on one side there are 4 prongs. However, on other side there are 2 prongs and a middle one, it is a long blade. So this long blade, it is used to retract the posterior canal wall anteriorly. So this instrument, it is of different for right and the left side. So how we determine the site of this instrument? So we hold the instrument like this. The blades, they should face towards the patient. Now this blade is on the right side, it is on our right side. So this will be used for the left ear of the patient. So we can remember like this, the side of the blade after holding it like this, in this instrument it is facing towards the right side. So this will be used for the left ear of the patient. Had this blade been here, that is on the left side of this instrument, so it would have been of the right side. So this particular, it is for the left ear of the patient. So Plaster hemostatic self-retaining mastoid retractor. Now this is Jenkins gouge. Now in earlier days during mastoidectomy, the bone over the mastoid cortex was removed using this gouge along with the hammer, that is mallet. But nowadays this instrument is no longer used. Micromotor drill is used to do the mastoidectomy nowadays. Other uses of this instrument are, it can also be used to remove the bone during the Cardwellar surgery, and sometimes in the maxillary crest in the nasal. However, for nose, there is a separate instrument which is Killian's gouge, which is a bayonet shape. So this is used. This was used in ear surgery to remove the mastoid bone, Jenkins gouge. So as I told you, that nowadays instead of the gouge and the mallet, we use a micromotor drill. So this is the micromotor drill. This is the handpiece of the micromotor drill, and this is the foot control of the micromotor drill. The micromotor drill, it can rotate generally rotates at 30,000 to 40,000 RPM, that is revolutions per minute, or it can be increased up to 80,000 as and when required. This is used along the with these burrs. So these are burrs. Burrs are of two types. This is the cutting burr and this is the diamond burr. The cutting burr is, it has stripes on its distal tip, and it cuts the bone. While the diamond burr, it does not have stripe. Generally it is also called a polishing burr. So it is used to smoothen the cavity. The burrs, they are made up of steel, tungsten carbide or titanium, and they come in different sizes from the 0.5 millimeter to 7 millimeter diameter of the tip and 45 to 70 centimeter length. Cutting burr, it is used when we want to remove a major chunk of the bone, that is initially when we start mastoidectomy, we can start with the cutting burr. And the maximum size of the burr for that particular area should be used to avoid any injury. As we move on to the vital areas, for example, the facial canal, the sinus plate, sinodural angle, or the dural plate, then we switch over from cutting to the diamond burr, because this is less traumatic and the chances of injury to the vital structures are more. This is the handpiece. The burrs are fixed in the handpiece. Then the handpiece is locked. This handpiece, it is connected to the machine. It is controlled by the foot switch, and this will change the speed of the this thing, rotation, revolutions, and then we can start drilling. Now these tiny instruments which we can see, they are the grommets. Grommets, they are also called ventilation tubes. So here we can see they are the packed, actually they are the packed ones. There are two grommets. They also come in different shapes, and accordingly they can be Donaldson, they can be Sheehy, they can be Shaha grommet. But these are also called ventilation tube, and they are used in after myringotomy, especially when the fluid is thick and we want to keep the myringotomy open for longer time. So we insert the grommet in patients with otitis media with effusion. Now because of the migration of the tympanic membrane epithelium laterally, peripheral migration, these grommets, they are self extruded after 4 to 5 weeks of insertion. This is ear speculum. Ear speculum also come in different types. Now this one, it has a round end. This is a Hartmann's ear speculum. Sometimes the end, it comes in bevel shaped, that is Shia. Sometimes there is a partial cleft present here, which is Rosin's, and many times there is a complete cleft present over here, which is called Tumarkin. So the use of this instrument, it is to examine the ear, to clean the ear of any fungal infection, to instill drops in the ear, medications in the ear, to in surgeries to inject the local anesthesia in the ear canal, and for microscopic examination and suction cleaning. So this is oral speculum. Yeah. The other uses of this burr besides mastoidectomy are, it is also used to remove bone for ossicular reconstruction, to sculpture the ossicles. A smaller size burr is used. Also it is used in DCR surgery to drill the lacrimal bone, especially when the bone is thick and it cannot be punched out with the punch forceps. And it is also used in mandibulectomies as well as mesialectomies to drill the bone. Thank you very much.